This video will be about the atom and how it can even exist. In the previous video, we have discussed some fundamental aspects of quantum mechanics, and with that in mind, let us go back to the Schrödinger equation and solve it for the simplest atom, namely the hydrogen atom. Even though this atom is simple, it can tell us a lot about atoms in general. While the larger atoms quickly become impossible to solve analytically, the lesson from solving the Schrödinger equation of the hydrogen atom is very instructive, and we can get an understanding for special quantum effects. In school, most people get introduced to the Bohr model. This model was put forward by Danish scientist Niels Bohr in 1913, as an improvement to the Rutherford's model from 1911. While the Bohr model is not completely correct, it was still a big step forward, and his work on the atomic structure and quantum mechanics gave him the Nobel Prize in 1922. The Bohr model can be derived as an approximation to the correct solution from solving the Schrödinger equation. Because it's simple and instructive, it's still taught in school, so let's do a recap of this model. In the Bohr model, a nucleus made from protons and neutrons is placed in the center. Around the nucleus, the electrons orbit in special shells which can accommodate a specific number of electrons. In this model, the electrons are only allowed to be in these discrete shells. The uncertainty principle of course tells us that this is impossible because we can't measure the orbit that precise. Nevertheless, the Bohr model came before the uncertainty principle, and the electrons approximately follow these discrete shells. In reality, the electrons orbit in specific electron clouds with some probability of where the electron is. But these electron clouds can be approximated by these discrete shells. The fact that electrons follow these orbits turns out to be crucial for the stability of the atom. One of the issues with classical electrodynamics is that the atom appears horribly unstable. If we look at the nucleus of the atom, it's positively charged, but the electrons are negatively charged. The electrons orbit the atom at velocities comparable to the speed of light. According to electromagnetism, these electrons should emit photons. These photons would then remove energy from the electron, and because the electron has opposite charge compared to the nucleus, it should be attracted to the nucleus. Eventually, all energy should radiate away as photons as the electron crashes into the nucleus. This, however, does not happen, partly thanks to the uncertainty principle, but more thanks to quantum mechanics in general. As Bohr correctly understood with this model, the electron must follow specific orbits, and due to the exclusion principle, there is only a limited amount of space in each shell. This is essentially what gives us the structure of the atom. Each orbit is then separated by integer multiples of Planck's constant, h bar. The electrons can change between free shells and emit or absorb photons in accordance to Planck's equation E equals to h mu. Now let us go into some more deep math and take a look at the Schrödinger equation to get more precise understanding of the atomic structure. We can consider the simple hydrogen atom with one electron and one proton in the nucleus. The first step is to convert our usual time-independent Schrödinger equation into the three-dimensional time-independent Schrödinger equation. To do this, we replace our differential with respect to x with the Laplacian operator. And the Laplacian operator is called this triangle nabla. Atoms are generally round, and therefore the most practical coordinates to describe the atom is spherical coordinates. Thus, we describe it in terms of the radius from the center, r, and the two angles, theta and phi. In these coordinates, one can write the Laplacian operator as nabla squared is equal to 1 over r squared, the differential of r with respect to r squared, and then the differential of r again, plus 1 over r squared times sine to the angle theta times the differential with respect to theta of sine theta and the differential with respect to theta, plus 1 over r squared times sine squared of theta times the double derivative with respect to phi. This equation is rather complicated, so we will not go into the details of how to solve the Schrödinger equation in this case. As always, we must also specify the potential in this case. Since the hydrogen atom is symmetric, the potential only depends on the radius, and we can write it as V equal to minus E squared divided by 4 pi epsilon naught times 1 over R plus H bar squared divided by 2m times L in brackets L plus 1 divided by R squared, where the first term is just the Coulomb potential and the second term is the centrifugal term. In this case, m is just the mass of the electron, E is the electron charge, and epsilon naught is the vacuum permittivity, and L is the angular quantum number associated with the angular momentum. Solving the Schrödinger equation will then give you the quantum mechanical equation describing the hydrogen atom, as we will see soon. Before diving into the solution to the hydrogen atom, it can be a good idea to discuss quantum numbers. As we will see soon, the wave function of the hydrogen atom is defined in terms of three quantum numbers, n, l and m. The first is n, and it is called the principal quantum number. It can take integer values from 1 and up, thus n equal to 1, 2, 3 and so forth. We can understand this number as the shell number in the Bohr model, thus the level where n equal to 1 is the first shell, and so on. We have been introduced to the angular quantum number L already, and it can take the values of 0 up to n minus 1. Thus, if n is 3, then L can be 0, 1 or 2. This number can be understood as the subshells of the atom, like the s, p and d orbitals. The Bohr model doesn't distinguish between subshells, but they are important for chemistry. We also have the magnetic number m, which is related to the energy shift of the shell. This number goes from minus L to L. Thus, if L is equal to 2, then m is equal to minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1 and 2. We also have an additional quantum number s, which is the spin number. This is not important for defining the wave function, but it plays a role in how many electrons which can fit in each shell. For an electron, s is either minus a half or plus a half. As a quick example, one can consider the case where n is equal to 1. In this case, l and m must be 0, thus we have that there is one s orbital shell available. As we discussed in relation to the exclusion principle, you can't have an electron in the same state. Thus, in our example, there's only one s orbital available, and there can only be two electrons, one with spin up and one with spin down, in order to have different quantum states. Now we are ready to look at the wave function for the hydrogen atom. It is very complicated, but atoms are complicated, and the hydrogen atom is one of the only atoms that have an analytical solution. We can thus express the wave function in terms of the quantum numbers n, l and m as psi of n, l and m is equal to the square root of 2 divided by na and that part cubed times n minus l minus 1 factorial divided by 2n and in brackets n plus l factorial and end of the square root times the exponential of minus r divided by na times 2r divided by na to the power of l times the Legendre polynomial of the quantum numbers n and l times the spherical harmonics, where a is the Bohr radius of around half an angstrom. We can see that it also depends on the Legendre polynomial and the spherical harmonics. As an example, if we choose the simple case of n equal to 1 again, then we also know that l and m is 0. This gives us that the psi of 1, 0, 0 is equal to 1 over the square root of pi a cubed times e to the power of minus R over A. And this is arguably the simplest solution. Nevertheless, I hope it makes sense how to obtain other solutions. Now, let's not spend more time on the ugly math and discuss results. By plugging in different numbers, we can obtain different possible orbitals for the electron in the hydrogen atom. The solutions where L is 0 gives the so-called s orbitals. These ones are the simplest orbitals, and the electron can be in some specific spherical shell. If L is equal to 1, we get the p orbitals, which are like two clouds on each side. Going up to L equal to 2, we get even more complicated structures of orbitals. In this case, they are mostly in four clouds evenly spaced around the nucleus, but there is also an orbital with a ring and two clouds on each side. There's also the f orbitals, which get even more complicated. If you're interested in the specifics, please Google atomic orbitals. The important lesson is that this wave function gives us all the possible orbitals where we may find the electrons. The results we have discussed today are generally supported by experiments, but even regular quantum mechanics is actually not the end of the story. Because quantum mechanics is not compatible with special relativity, it doesn't correctly handle the fact that the electron is moving at a very high velocity. Today we have experiments which are so sensitive that we can see the issues with the solution from the Schrödinger equation. I should highlight that for most practical purposes, the solution presented in this video is good enough. But to get the full picture, we must consider quantum field theories, which is compatible with special relativity. I hope this was insightful. As always, please like, comment, and subscribe, and stay tuned for the next video.